I actually decided at the last minute to change my focus just a little bit and not focus so much on the border states as focus in particular on Missouri story. Knowing, of course, that the lecture series is devoted to black history, unfortunately this talk won't focus exclusively on black history, but more how African Americans and white Americans in this particular state during this particularly critical time in some sense came unhinged over the issue of slavery and during the war. It's a tough story, but it's also an important one in understanding how in many ways slavery played into so much of how people came to see themselves, particularly white people, in this part of the world and in this state. And so the story really is about, and when I use the term Southernization, it is about the creation of white identity in the mid-19th century, the aftermath, or should I say the prelude during the experience of war and in the aftermath of that war. So, without further ado, let's get to the talk. In about 1910, William Barton Napton, to reach over here and do this, I think, I don't believe we've got a wireless. In about 1910, William Barclay Napton's eldest son, Billy, recalled of his late father, a longtime Missouri State Supreme Court judge, that, quote, "I heard him say once toward the latter part of his life that there was not a drop of Yankee blood in his veins. If there was," and this is his father's quote, "I would take a knife and let it out," to use his own words. No native Virginian ever disliked a Yankee more than he. Judging by Napton's apparently strong pro-Southern sentiments, one might assume that he was a fiery secessionist planter, a product of the Cotton States, with deep blood ties to match his deep convictions on the course of the South. Nothing could be further from the truth. Napton was a native New Jerseyite and a graduate of the College of New Jersey, later Princeton University, who moved to Missouri in 1832 not to take up the position of a slaveholding farmer, but largely because he was told that a young man with a law degree could go far in the West. And Missouri in 1832 was about as far west as a young man could go. And so he went. What connected this respected judge with the Deep South planters was that by the outbreak of the Civil War, Napton was the owner of the trustee of 46 slaves who toiled collectively in and on his Saline County home and farm. His judicial rulings consistently supported the constitutionality of slavery, and he used the bench to offer government protection of the peculiar institution in his state. To the end of his life, he extolled the moral superiority of a slave society and avowed the unconstitutionality of the federal government's wartime intrusions in border slave states such as Missouri. How Napton became an apologist for slavery and advocate of the lost cause mythology is a story representative of white Missourians' Civil War odyssey as a whole. Historians have found the border slave states, especially Missouri and Kentucky, difficult to categorize in their studies of 19th century America. Routinely, they have considered them part of the American South, largely from the mistaken perception of a fixed early American boundary between freedom and slavery. Of course, such a view ignores the nature, and more important, the lasting consequences of the Civil War, particularly in its most contested space, the Western border states. And of course, we all do know, and if we don't, we should be reminded that this is the 150th anniversary of the beginning of that war, and so there are lots of Civil War sesquicentennial celebrations. So this particular talk, in some sense, will help to explain that as well in this particular place. One of the war's greatest and most overlooked ironies is this. How in the process of coming to support the Union, much of the West, the then West, actually became a part of the now South. Today I'll discuss four interrelated phenomena during the years surrounding the war that contributed to a marked change in many white Missourians' identity, one that was always contested, but one of which would markedly define the state's history and politics. The first was the conflict over slavery's expansion into the Western territories that culminated in the fight over Kansas, which I won't talk much about today. The second, or should I say, conflict with Kansas. The second was the hard war waged in this state and the widespread violations of civil liberties brought on by a federal occupation of the ostensibly loyal, self-declared neutral state. These were themselves a product of a brutal guerrilla war that commenced in Missouri almost as the war began, but picked up appreciably after a particular point in the war that I'll discuss. The third was African-American military enlistment that was, in fact, the springboard to emancipation in this state and other border slave states. And last, the political redemption of the state, by which a unique lost cause southernized many white Missourians, like Napkin, by the 1880s. At the core of all of these was the institution of slavery, which, when dying, triggered the various beginnings of how the West was lost narrative, and which would be completed only when the peculiar institution was long dead and buried. Yet it would reach out from its grave for decades, perhaps even to the present in some ways. Catchy subtitle, I know. You'll get the point in a minute. In 1858, Missouri pro-slavery Whig James S. Rollins cautioned his son, a cadet at the U.S. Military Institute at West Point, to say, quote, to the northern and southern cadets, that you belong to neither section, that you are a true son of the Great West. As Rollins articulated especially well, and surprisingly in such a late antebellum day, despite white Missourians' continued support for the institution of slavery, in fact, I would argue because of it, most largely believed themselves to be neither southern nor northern, but something better than either. If anything regional, they considered themselves Westerners. This conscious Western identity was articulated best by Missouri's pro-slavery star, Kentucky-born David Rice Acheson. It's instructive of what these Western border residents' ability to separate slaveholding from any peculiarly southern status. An able Confederate of John C. Calhoun's, Acheson's well-known fire-eating words certainly did not make him a planter, just as Napkins did not either, but rather a bachelor lawyer and circuit court judge prior to attaining the U.S. House and Senate. Acheson, the son of a small slaveholding Kentucky yeoman, had removed to western Missouri and had become leader of the region's common whites, not by assuming the part of any compensate seigneur. Indeed, until the Civil War years, Acheson owned at most one bond person. Acheson was anything but alone as a small or even non-slaveholding border resident who adhered to the institution of slavery and upheld it. In 1860, Missouri's 115,000 slaves accounted for just under 10% of its residents, just half that of Kentucky, and the smallest of all the slave states, save Elfin, Delaware. Its 24,000 odd slaveholders would comprise just 2.3% of its total free population. The percentage of its slaves within its slave population proved a far cry from the Deep South, and especially states like Mississippi and Louisiana, because it was predominantly a land of small slaveholders. No Missourian owned more than 300 slaves, and the average Missourian owned less than 5. But it was growing, slavery, especially in its westernmost counties, this region, where the Slave Populations Act actually doubled in the 1850s, faster than anywhere else in the nation, even faster than the Deep South. Characteristic of the upcountry portions of the lower South, planters did not enjoy hegemony in Missouri. A non-slaveholding yeomanry made up the backbone of the state's leadership, even compared with other border slave states. As the nation divided over the issue of chattel slavery, these Missourians heard well, in the northern condemnations of the peculiar institution, the heavy tolls of an accepted superiority, both moral and economic, of a free society over a slave society. Though in the sectional arena, the abolitionists directed these jeremiads largely at deep southerners, pro-slavery Missourians found themselves squarely in two lines of fire. One, the abolitionists, aimed at slaveholders generally, and another, the free soilers, directed at slaveholding Westerners specifically. Free labor and Western free soil advocates, some in Missouri, most in St. Louis, condemned Southern slave society as socially stagnant, without incentive, degrading the laborers, and touted the West as holding the future greatness of America, a vista achieved only by the prohibition of slavery from this region. Ohio and Salmon P. Chase held that a free West, removed of slavery would offer, quote, Freedom, not serfdom. Freeholds, not tenancies. Democracy, not despotism. Education, not ignorance. Progress, not stagnation or retrogression. Free soil Democrat and St. Louis slaveholder Frank Blair proclaimed boldly that, quote, the wealth and the political power of the country will in a very little time reside in its geographical center. What he meant by geographical center, of course, was the nation's middle border, this region, of which Missouri was part. But he added almost wistfully that once one crossed the Mississippi eastward into slaveless Illinois, one could not help but view, quote, the splendid farms of Sangamon and Morgan without permitting an envious sigh to escape him at the evident superiority of free labor. Even slaveholders, some in this region, saw that slavery itself was not good for the nation. Blair was one. There would be others. The Northern assault on slavery and the restrictionist effort intrinsically relegated Southern slaveholders to the status of inferiors, whether moral or numerical. Indeed, Atchison became John C. Calhoun's Southern Rights standard bearer, not from any long-standing belief in his or Missourian's general Southern heritage, but because of the specter of a Northern majoritarianism. Far from simply calling for any general restriction of government power in order to preserve individual freedoms, liberty-loving Westerners, and especially Democrats, generally believed, as did Calhoun and Atchison, that too much liberty in the hands of those unfit to exercise it was democracy's curse. Those so unfit in this sectional era, according to these men and women, were the liberalized Northerners, especially those now influencing the national government as they sought to, what one of these contemporaries called, monopolize the Western territories, but also African Americans, who they judged as inferior and unfit for freedom. The triumph of democracy had, in effect, empowered unequal, yet majority, Northern and Black peoples, extending them the right and thus the power, by virtue of the mass franchise, to claim the nation's future, and that future was in the West. The charge of societal inferiority, combined with anti-slavery Northerners' attempts to limit slavery's extension, caused many white Missourians to see the Northern element as a tyrannical majority intent upon oppressing an enlightened minority. That, of course, is the essence of majoritarianism. In attempting to limit the South's ability to carry their property wherever they chose, the North was clearly limiting their constitutional freedoms. Denying slaveholders their constitutional right to property, and thus to freedom, was in effect the denial of equality. Yet another proof that free soilers, and not slaveholders, intended to destroy democracy in the nation. The defense of slavery gave way to one more germane for Westerners, that of the defense of white minority rights, a concept that the Democrat Atchison grasped firmly. In the debate over the organization of Nebraska that would result in the Kansas-Nebraska Act, Atchison vowed, quote, I will vote for a bill that leaves the slaveholder and non-slaveholder upon terms of equality. Another Missourian, Whit Henry Geyer, argued similarly. The antagonism and hostility between the states and its people, engendered by the agitation of the slavery question, he charged, is aggravated by hostile legislation and the struggle for political power by a sectional party warring upon the institutions of one half the states of the Union. The defense of individual rights, heard today very much in our modern political discourse, drew many white Missourians into a general acceptance of the concept of Southern rights, with slavery at the notion's core. Southern rights, as they are termed, scoffed one Missouri editor who saw clearly the implications of the term, implicitly involved defiance against the majority and its authority. More ominously, its sympathetic and widespread use in country parlance suggested a retreat from the Western identity that had shaped white Missourians' worldview, and a move toward a distinctive identity based upon separation, party and otherwise, over slavery. In the heat of the sectional debate, that identity clearly found sympathy in the plight of the beleaguered South, prompting one Western Missouri newspaper editor to adopt as the moniker of his paper, The Southern Advocate. The victimization imagery embedded in the concept of Southern rights was easily conjured by white Missourians, as Henry S. Geyer dutifully reminded his Senate colleagues, quote, who remembered how little their rights were respected by the North in the memorable struggle of 1820. Of course, he's referring to the Missouri Compromise. Indeed, Atchison outright condemned, quote, that infamous restriction passed by Congress of 1820, commonly called the Missouri Compromise, one that Illinois and Abraham Lincoln revered enough to re-enter politics in 1854 at the passage of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, which overturned that compromise. He considered it sacred, and he felt that it was a national crisis that had been overturned to allow popular sovereignty into the Western territories, or to let the people decide for themselves. As Northerners reunited against slavery and the slave power by adhering to the Free Soil Movement, many Missourians heard much more than condemnations of the South. They heard themselves condemned as slaveholders, first, and then, by yet another sin to them, that of association, as Southerners who shared their commitment to chattel slavery. Northerners and Northwesterners and lumping Missourians together with the South as a result of one lone shared institution ignored, quote, what one person called the identity of interest and feeling and destiny, end quote, that Missourians hoped yet prevailed over all of the Western states, free and slave. Considering theirs the freest society in the world, Westerners generally did, both because of their Western rural residence and their pervasive egalitarianism and commitment to liberty, by different terms and by different standards, Missourians opposed the free soil arguments as slanderous attacks by an undemocratic host upon a free and loyal people. Now, listening to the widespread attacks upon the South, and thus upon them, many white Missourians at last began, however cautiously, to consider their interests distinct from those of their free Western neighbors, and consistent with those of the beleaguered slaveholding South. Indeed, to them, a sense of honor was at stake. William B. Napton observed this: the South regards it as a point of honor not to submit, and the North regards it as a point of honor to persist. So it is merely a point of honor upon which we split. This is, however, enough. Though Napton was a former editor, his choice of we was no mere editorial form. Missouri's Southernization had begun. In direct response to the Northern attacks against the South and slavery, white Missourians, pro-slavery and even free soil if convenient, adopted the mantra of Southerners to suit their best purposes. Prior to the 1840s, little evidence exists of these Missourians having applied the term to themselves at all, in large part because the nation itself had not yet sectionalized so as to create the region in a national consciousness. The term Southern, as Missourians, white Missourians, employed it initially, was a metaphor for slaveholder, regardless of the individual's stance on slavery's extension. In 1844, Thomas Hart Benton, then the Leonin senator from Missouri, responded defiantly to his free state antagonists in Congress by affirming, quote, I'm a Southerner by birth, I'm a slaveholder, and shall take the fate of other slaveholders and every aggression upon that species of property. Ultimately, what Benton would not do is to allow slavery spread into the territories. He had no problem with slavery where it existed. Similarly, in 1853, Frank Blair, who we mentioned before, always also an anti-slip expansion slaveholder, sought to temper the firestorm by proclaiming, quote, I am a Southern man by birth and identified with Southern institutions by my interest in education. Obviously, Missourians yet reserved their employment of the term Southern or Southerner exclusively for the benefit of outsiders, in particular those who now posed a threat to the peculiar institution. By the mid-1850s, those who evinced anything short of wholesale support for the institution and its extension into the Western territories, namely Kansas, were subject to bitter political attack. Those born in non-slaveholding states proved especially vulnerable. Benjamin Gratz Brown captured this distinction most completely when responding to New York-born state senator Robert M. Stewart's attack on Benton as an abolitionist. Pointing out Stewart's northern birth, Brown, a native Kentuckian, threw doubt on Stewart's pro-slavery stance based upon it. Unlike Stuart, Brown argued, quote, I'm a Southern man, in feeling and in principle. The place of my birth forbids the ridiculous nonsense of abolitionism. Ironically, Gratz Brown would later become a leader of the state's wartime emancipationists, so much for his Southernness. Perhaps more than those in any other state, many Missourians in the 1850s drew the sharpest distinctions between their neighbors, based not upon sectional hailing, but by their adherence or opposition to slavery. In other words, their politics. Lying astride two now contested borders, one north-south, the other east-west, their western border now open to popular sovereignty by virtue of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, many pro-slavery Missourians clearly saw their vulnerable geography. As the nation's northwesternmost slave state, they inhabited a slaveholding peninsula in an angry sea of free soil. These Missourians did not have the luxury of granting exemptions to anyone, even those born in slaveholding states. Indeed, with grim irony, William Napton took aim at those of Benton and Blair's ilk while pointing out the imperfection of the new Southern identity swirling around Missouri at the time. A man's opinions are not to be determined by his place of birth, Napton observed. Because a man is born and raised in a slave state does not prevent him from being a free soiler or an abolitionist. Kentucky is a slave state, yet I will venture that one half of the Kentuckians who emigrate here are free soilers, one fourth out and out abolitionists. They are not slaveholders, though born and raised in a slave state. And wherever they are, they still entertain anti-slavery sentiments. The political adjuncts of the Northern Free Soilers stay scattered here and there throughout the South and, quote, born and raised in slave states are the most dangerous of the whole tribe. Such declarations are therefore entitled to little or no importance. Such declarations would cause the man, or should cause people, to make that person closely watched. Atchison concurred. Put confidence in no man for any station of public trust, he cautioned a group of supporters, who is not known to be true to the institutions of the state and the rights of our citizens. The notion that individual rights to property were under attack soon drew many white border slave staters to accept a slightly broader concept, that of Southern rights, with slavery at the notion's core. The idea allowed many liberty-loving, non-slaveholding moderates in this region, who had themselves supported slavery only in the abstract, to deepen their pro-slavery conservative principles, as they then termed them, by supporting the minority rights of others whose individual rights to chattel property were directly beset. Indeed, in 1850, 24-year-old Jefferson W. Limbaugh, a new North Carolina immigrant, commenced publishing a pro-slavery newspaper in the Mississippi River town of Cape Girardeau that he called Southern Democrat, intent upon, in his words, vindicating the rights of the South and the principles of non-intervention in the unfortunate slave controversy. And of course, as some of you have likely already surmised, this then conservative was indeed a forebearer of our current conservative bullhorn, Rush Limbaugh. In other words, pro-slavery runs deep. I thought you'd get into a debate with him on the radio about that. True to its white residents' Western identities, neither Missouri nor Kentucky sent representatives to a Southern convention held at Nashville, Tennessee in 1850. Yet when a border state conference was held in Frankfort, Kentucky in May 1861, only those states' representatives were in attendance. Ironically, just prior to the presidential election in 1860, Missourians elected a governor with an extreme pro-slavery reputation, and whose reputation included possible secessionism. Yet, whatever plans Governor Claiborne Fox Jackson might have laid to initiate secession in his state, took a dramatic turn on the day of the convention election. In a remarkably peaceful vote, unionism prevailed over disunion with a thunderous resonance. Of 140,000 votes cast, unionists, whether conditional or unconditional, and they received nearly equal votes, hold nearly 110,000 of them, or just less than 8 in every 10. So sure were Missouri's voters of their desire to preserve their connection to the federal union that not one avowed secessionist candidate received election to the convention among the 99 delegates so elected, though in several counties the margin was razor thin. But yet neither did Missourians reward those known to be Republicans. Only four were elected, and all were from St. Louis. Within a month, the convention would hold to its bargain. When its members calmly voted 98-1 in favor of a resolution declaring that, quote, no adequate cause existed to impel Missouri to dissolve her connections with the federal union. Thus, Missouri became the only slave convention that voted, or state convention, that voted not to sever its ties with that union. Only months earlier, Missouri voters had rewarded Northern Democrat Stephen A. Douglas, architect of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, his only victory, rejecting, as one Missouri editor quipped, both union splitters and rail splitters, which I think is a wonderful phrase. And the war came, and as Abraham Lincoln said in his first inaugural address, and the state declared itself neutral. Soon enough, the Yankees came too, many of them strongly anti-slavery and from the northernmost parts of the Western Free States. These white Missourians, to them, were pukes, disloyalists. Neutrality, by the way, was seen even by the President, Lincoln, as synonymous with disloyalty. Southerners, and they quickly made hard war upon them. In their capacity as law enforcers, the state militia and their commanders often settled old personal scores against pro-slavery neighbors or flaunted their position of power by its very use with federal imprimatur. George Caleb Bingham, the artist of the painting that began the slideshow, who was an officer in the Missouri State Militia before becoming the state's treasurer during the war, made clear his intent for hard-handedness in 1861 when he declared this: "The neutrality policy, which our friends have been generally urging, has never struck me as being manly or patriotic. To pronounce secession treason in one breath, and in the next to declare neutrality between the traitors and the constituted authorities who are endeavoring to maintain the government seems to me to be twin brother to the treason. The fact is, governments are for the purposes of coercion alone. Those who are willing to do right need no laws to impel them to the performance of their duty." By war's end, Bingham will have profoundly shifted his position, as you saw in the opening slide, as he watched routinely as federal and militia commanders levied or made arbitrary arrests of disloyal citizens, or at least those judged disloyal, especially those who had not taken the oath, thus infuriating the white civilian populace. The widespread misemployment of federal policies for suppression of civil unrest, common in all wars, might have provided choice grist for the long-lasting bitterness among many white Missourians, slaveholding and not. Despite recognizing the inexactness of designations of loyalty and disloyalty, union officials routinely depended on local unionists for their designations of loyal residents, local residents, that were themselves implicitly political and often personal. The state militia soon became both extension and enforcer of this barometer of loyalty. In July 1862, all able-bodied white males between the ages of 18 and 45 were required to take the oath of allegiance and enroll for militia duty, or be placed on the local assessment list as being disloyal. Undisciplined troops only compounded the misery of many rural Missourians, especially those who lived on the border with Kansas, here, where Jayhawkers' retributions for the long border conflict that we didn't talk about tonight devolved into freebooting and outright terrorism of residents whom the Kansans viewed uniformly as traitors. These Kansans initiated a scorched earth policy years before commanders in the East employed such extremism. One Jackson County resident calculated his losses from six raids on his farm between January 1861 and August 1863 at just over $4,100, 84% of which occurred on one raid in the latter month when Union troops destroyed his house, barn, carriage, wagon, kitchen, and smokehouse. Such treatment of civilians occurred throughout the state. Tens of thousands of them fled their homes. Federal policy and its enforcement, arbitrary or not, often moved far beyond mere comparison. As early as 1861, John C. Fremont, then the Western Department's commander, set down capital parameters when he proclaimed, quote, "All persons who shall be taken with arms in their hands within these lines shall be tried by court-martial, and if found guilty, will be shot." Although Lincoln modified the order so that none could be executed without his consent, most white Missourians were shocked. The following May, District Commander John M. Schofield reiterated the intent of Federals to mete out harsh retribution for the mounting guerrilla war by proclaiming, quote, "The time has passed when insurrection and rebellion in Missouri can cloak itself under the guise of honorable warfare." And he ordered his men to shoot on sight any person caught in arms. No trial. Federal authorities made good their commander's orders and regularly executed captured guerrillas, even before Quantrill's famous raid on Lawrence, Kansas, when a virtual manhunt occurred and hundreds of suspected partisans received summary executions. Perhaps the best known of Missouri's countless atrocities occurred in October 1862, when 10 suspected partisans held in local prisons were shot in a public spectacle at Palmyra in retaliation for the disappearance of a local unionist. The incident has since borne the bitter epithet, the Palmyra Massacre. And against the backdrop of all of this, perhaps the single most important factor in this Southernization. The wartime liberation of bond people on the border began well before and despite Abraham Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation, and despite widespread government disavowals. As early as 1861, conservative unionist Thomas T. Gant of St. Louis wrote to then Department Commander William S. Harney of a conversation he had with a Greene County resident, who, quote, "asked me whether I supposed it was the intention of the United States government to interfere with the institution of Negro slavery in Missouri, or any slave state, or impair the security of that description of property." Harney, himself a slaveholding Tennessean, responded, quote, "I'm not a little astonished that such a question could be seriously put. I should as soon expect to hear that the orders of the government were directed towards the overthrow of any other kind of property as of this in Negro slaves." Harney's naivete matched those of slaveholders like Thomas Gant. Both were convinced that their state's stand for the Union would protect the peculiar institution within its borders. Indeed, Fremont's proclamation, summary execution for guerrillas, which in addition to ordering them, also ordered the freedom of slaves of disloyal masters, and that was in September 1861, a full year before Lincoln would issue his Emancipation Proclamation. Lincoln revoked this portion of Fremont's order, but for many white Missourians, they saw it as a harbinger of what was to come. The border slave state's exclusion from the Emancipation Proclamation, by the way, if you didn't know this or you're not familiar with it, Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation took effect on January 1st, 1863, and it excluded four states, and they were all loyal slave states, Delaware, Maryland, Kentucky, and Missouri, meaning that those states would not have to give up their slaves if the war would end. Meaning that Missourians, white Missourians, believed that by remaining loyal, they would be rewarded by maintaining slavery. The disloyal states of the Confederacy would be the ones punished. That's what they believed. Following James H. Lane's lead more than a year earlier, in 1861, in the summer of 1863, Thomas Ewing, then commander of the Department of the Border in Kansas, Leavenworth, proposed raids from Kansas into the border counties of Missouri to escort slaves out of the state where they could enlist in formed black regiments. This was specifically prohibited by the Emancipation Proclamation, which of course, excluding the border states, did not allow for black enlistment in these states. Enlisting the bondmen of disloyal owners was done neither in secret nor without the highest authority in Missouri. When explaining to the president his reasoning for allowing August 63's order number 11 that was presented in the first slide, which depopulated four Missouri counties bordering Kansas and set or became the destructive model for William T. Sherman's later March to the Sea. And it was no surprise, it shouldn't come as a great surprise, that Sherman was Ewing's foster brother. So the two of them had conversed on this. In explaining this to the president, John Schofield, who was commander of the Department of Missouri, argued that, quote, the removal from those counties of all slaves entitled to their freedom, effectively all of them, given that nearly all owners had been expelled by Order No. 11, would guarantee that families of guerrillas would never return to these border counties. And thus, they were taken. When in October 1863, the president, having suspended the recently begun recruitment of slaves of disloyal masters in Missouri and Maryland, Lincoln's Secretary of War, Edwin Stanton, hastily reminded the president that, quote, military necessity required the recruitment of African Americans in the border states. And this is his quote, whether they be free or not. 2 days later, Lincoln quietly gave the order in Maryland and Tennessee with additional stipulation that loyal owners would be compensated $300 for each male slave enlisted in the army. Few, if any, of them ever got it. But he did not yet extend recruiting to Kentucky or into Missouri. He upheld the ban, waiting for the outcome of the fall elections there. The fall elections in Missouri saw the success of the emancipationists, or the radicals as they were called widely, and growing opposition to the state convention's foot-dragging emancipation that plan that they had been talking about, moved Lincoln finally to act. Heeding widening calls for black enlistment, particularly by African Americans like Frederick Douglass. In November, Lincoln authorized Schofield to issue General Orders No. 135, ordering the widespread recruitment of African American volunteers, slaves, contrabands, and free blacks for federal military service in Missouri. Compensation was available for loyal slaveholders losing slave men to military service, provided they filed deeds of manumission. The latter requirement ultimately cost most of those who actually applied any hopes for compensation. In truth, most refused, white owners refused entirely to apply for compensation. They were outraged. More even than emancipation, the enlistment of black troops signaled the disintegration of slavery in border states like Missouri. The specter of armed black men carved even deeper partisan lines into already fractured white populaces. Our wives and daughters are panic-stricken, wrote one Lafayette County resident, and a reign of terror as black as hell itself envelops our country. While another spat that black enlistment was nothing more than an abolition scheme to steal Negroes. One self-described, quote, loyal man, faithful to the Union and the Constitution of the United States, who as of June 1863 yet retained a portion of his slaves, condemned enlistment as, quote, evil by civil process. Supreme Court Justice John Ryland was more direct. The President's proclamation of 1st January 1863 does not embrace Missouri, he protested. Why should the radicals enforce it here at the point of a bayonet? We ask a repeal of this abolition order, this military license to steal our Negroes. The reality of armed black men in their midst was for some the last straw, white Missourians. We are exiles, forced to leave our home under fear of violence and assassination. Elvira Scott wrote grimly from mid-Missouri. She packed up her belongings for St. Louis. The sound of fife and drum was heard beating up Negro recruits with the low and vicious. White men who hated us and persecuted us were around me. All day, the marching of blacks went on. It was my last day in Miami. Former slaves' activism, including committing violence against whites, especially in areas near contraband camps, was not entirely idle fear of these nervous slaveholders. Black men under arms had been part of Jayhawker squads that had raided citizen farms in western Missouri nearly since 1861. Just days before she left her home, Elvira Scott was certain that the men in the night she heard killing her hogs were not white but black soldiers. Indeed, on the day she heard news of Order No. 11, she witnessed the establishment of a recruiting and contraband camp in the nearby river town of Miami. Actually, I was supposed to put that up earlier. That's the one I was looking for. This establishment of this contraband camp was signaled by a procession passing her home, led by a squad of federal soldiers, and this is how she described it, carrying the flag, headed by 11 six-mule teams drawing wagons filled with Negro women and children. Behind them was a large procession of 240 Negro men. Disturbed that her own slaves celebrated the passing of the procession, she became more anxious when a neighbor told her that one freedman had boasted, quote, they were sent here to tear up the secesh. That's a common term for secessionists or disloyalists, root and branch, and that they were going to do it. When she learned that, and she learned that many of these new neighbors of hers had received arms, she left for St. Louis hastily. The widespread fear that black enlistment would follow emancipation and confiscation caused other pro-slavery residents to double down on protections of the peculiar institution. To safeguard their chattel property, Missouri masters sent them east across the Mississippi to Kentucky, either for safekeeping with family or friends in western Kentucky or to Louisville's slave markets. In November 1863, federal army officials estimated that 1,000 Missouri slaves had passed through the Louisville slave markets in a two-month period. Officials at all levels enforced the state's slave laws, preventing the transportation of slaves without masters' permission, within or without state boundaries, and threatened lawsuits to force operators of railroads and riverboats to refuse to transport all African Americans. Others prohibited the employment of slaves without their masters' permission, making fugitives and contrabands nearly unemployable. Thousands of Missouri slaves fled to recruiting camps. That's where that was supposed to go. And other military installations, often in neighboring states. Rather than accept the inevitability of black liberation, many white Missourians resisted the revolutionary social change by unleashing their fury by joining in the partisan warfare, the guerrilla war, that exploded in the state nearly with the coming of emancipation. Although guerrilla activity of all kinds had begun early in the war, it increased precipitously after Lincoln issued his Emancipation Proclamation. The entire state, but especially the southern and western portions, suffered a war within a war, a partisan war that erupted with a fury beyond that found elsewhere in the entire nation. In fact, the ousted state government's quest for legitimacy within the Confederacy, however successful within or without Missouri, served only as a model and adjunct to the true civil war in this state, one that operated like the state itself on the margin of the military conflict. While as many as 30,000 Missourians fought in uniform for the Confederacy, only 1/4 of its eligible men, in case you're wondering, thousands more fought as guerrillas, subjecting Union soldiers and civilians in virtually all sections of the state to more than 3 years of rampant bushwhacking, sniping, hit-and-run raiding, arson, and murder. By one estimate, nearly 27,000 Missouri citizens lost their lives at the hands of these guerrillas and partisan raiders, whose ubiquity has prompted historian James M. McPherson's claim that, quote, more than any other state, Missouri suffered the horrors of internecine warfare and the resulting hatreds, which persisted for decades after Appomattox. The coincidence of this inside war, as one historian has called the guerrilla war, full-flowered, and black enlistment cannot be ignored. The provost marshal at Lexington had captured the contagion of residents' bitterness over emancipation when he wrote in August 1863 that, quote, the Negro in this county is the all-inspiring theme of many of the people. It is not the rebellion, the bushwhackers, the rebel sympathizers in Missouri, but the Negro that, in his estimation, is the source of all our trouble and the great question that divides the people. Hundreds of men who were not for the Negro would be Union men are now very doubtful. Many of them make the preservation of the institution of slavery a condition precedent to the Union, thereby effectually identifying their interests with the rebellion. Perhaps more important, Union troops and loyalist citizens were not the only targets of these guerrillas. Former and current slaves bore the brunt of the terrain of terror. One such bushwhacker claimed that he had been, quote, instigated by the late slave owners to hang and shoot every Negro he can find absent from their old plantations. This extension of violence to black and unionist Missourians reflects more than the broadening of the war's scope. Symbolically, rural borderites linked slavery's death with the tyranny of the federal government and lashed out. Statutory emancipation did little to stem either the violence or resultant resentment. As Clinton B. Fisk, a federal commander of militia in central Missouri, where slaveholding was densest, wrote from his vantage in March 1865, quote, slavery dies hard. I hear its expiring agonies and witness its contortions and death in every quarter of my district. In Boone, Howard, Randolph, and Callaway, the Emancipation Ordinance, and by the way, he's talking about the state ordinance which was passed in January 1865, ending slavery in Missouri, has caused disruption of society equal to anything I saw in Arkansas or even Mississippi in the year 1863. Led by St. Louis Attorney Charles D. Drake, a strong abolitionist who had spearheaded the convention government's emancipation ordinance, freeing all Missouri slaves immediately in January 1865, the Constitutional Convention and legislature effectively disfranchised all those who had either served or even supported the Confederacy. The new, quote, Drake Constitution required what was called an ironclad oath that guaranteed past as well as future loyalty for voting and holding public office and provided state funding for public education for both white and black residents. It did not, however, offer suffrage or office-holding rights to the newly emancipated African Americans in the state. The resultant Constitution was bitterly contested, passing by less than 2,000 votes out of nearly 86,000 cast in a referendum statewide in early June 1865. Drake soon took his seat in the U.S. Senate, elected there by a radical state legislature, eager to reward him for his controversial leadership. Only a decade later, the politics of memory was fast enabling a rejuvenated Democratic Party, dominated not by moderates, but by former Confederates now, to reassert traditional state dominance in a post-war world. In 1874, as the exiled former Confederates began to return to Missouri, the Democrats regained power in the state and re-enfranchised former Confederates. A year later, a new constitutional convention called by public referendum met to, as one St. Louis Democrat characterized the radicals, Drake Constitution, wiped from the statute books that sum of all villains. All but eight of the 68 men who comprised that body were conservative Democrats. Conservative, of course, meaning pro-slavery. And three-fourths, even though slavery was dead, and three-fourths of the group had been born in what were then slave states, 24 in Kentucky alone. More than half of those present had either served, whether in the military or government, or supported the Confederacy. The chairman, Waldo P. Johnson, had done both. Radicals were thrust out, and with them their infamous Constitution, and retaining strength in but a few Missouri counties and in St. Louis. Former Confederates swept into state offices, including Thomas Coe Reynolds, the once rebel lieutenant governor, who served in the state legislature. And for the next 35 years, these men would enjoy untrammeled political power. What emerged entwined was a post-war Confederate renaissance, a backlash initiated by many residents to the state, to the hard war and the bitter post-war that they were and had suffered through. Like their counterparts in other border states, these white Missourians sought to control the politics of selective memory by immortalizing those who sacrificed their lives, repelling federal, not Confederate invaders. Such memorials did more than simply honor the valiant dead, however. They politicized the memory of the war to their advantage. In a brief 10-year period, even before its leading characters had faded from memory or power, Missourians virtually rewrote their political history, constructing a Confederate heritage that most residents had largely disclaimed during the war itself. Although three times as many soldiers fought for the Union as for the Confederacy, within a few years, and by the way, of those, some 8,000 or 9,000 were black. Within a few years of the war's end, small towns and cities throughout Missouri began erecting monuments honoring the Confederate dead. One can see such defiance nowhere better than in Palmyra, Missouri, where a granite obelisk on the courthouse lawn stands silent vigil, a reminder of the atrocity the community had suffered at the hands of federal troops. Former Confederates such as Daniel M. Frost plied the state and private benefactors and the newly formed Sons of Confederate Veterans. These are actually a number of Price's veterans. That's the Sons of Confederate Veterans Missouri Division placard. And also the United Daughters of the Confederacy, both having Missouri divisions, to establish a Confederate veterans home in Higginsville. You can see closely, that's the UDC's plaque at the what is today the market of the Confederate home, as well as an accompanying veterans cemetery for Confederates only. Such memorials serve not just to honor the valiant dead, but also as counterweight to charges of these soldiers' unpatriotic and traitorous behavior. Aided by former Confederate newspapermen like Kansas City's John Newman Edwards, who reconstructed Jesse James and other guerrillas' wartime partisanship into a mythology of principled defense against centralized authority, white Missourians sought to preserve the memory of those who sacrificed their lives repelling federal invaders from their local states. That's the Shelby Monument in Kansas City. Joe Shelby. The act of memorialization bound Missourians and Kentuckians with the other slave states, the other Confederate states, not only in the replication of their activities, as was occurring throughout the South, but also by entwining their shared experience of war. Because these border residents' version of the conflict was different than that of most of the Confederate states, the prism of its residents' memory tilted slightly. In a state that did not officially secede, these memorials countered temporal charges of their soldiers' unpatriotic and traitorous behavior by offering timeless memorials to the contrary. Constructing a memory that now placed Antebellum and Missouri firmly in the Confederacy allowed its post-war leaders and voters, to appease an anger born of a deep-seated resentment of the outcome of the war and its experience in their state. But it also assuaged the nagging insecurity of their and their state's collateral place in the Confederacy. Once this Confederate mystique conquered the state's politics, it capped a process that had spanned decades by thousands of white Missourians claiming that they were and always had been rebels, and by extension, Southerners. Many of Missouri's white residents now articulated a Southern identity by which they transcended the immediate celebration of a Confederate heritage or even a lost cause. Inverting Carl von Clausewitz's famous dictum, white Missourians in the 1870s and 80s employed politics as other means of achieving war goals. Perhaps the most lasting symbol of Missouri's Confederate heritage, at which at the same time served as a bridge to the adoption of the Southern identity in at least one portion of the state, was the adoption of the term Little Dixie as a moniker for the former slaveholding center of that state. Unknown before and during the war itself, a Kansas City newspaperman in 1941 traced the term to the congressional candidacy of John B. Hale, who popularized it as a description for the Central River counties while campaigning in the second congressional district in 1887. Not surprisingly, the emergence of Little Dixie approximated the elections of former Confederate John S. Marmaduke to the governorship, nearly simultaneous to the election of two U.S. senators who were themselves former Confederate officers, all in the mid-1880s. The common sobriquet Little Dixie reflects more than past and current voting trends. It stands as a distorted symbol of what Missourians believe they always were culturally and were never politically, neither of which was true. As the state uniquely experienced the fractious Civil War, regional identity fits best within the political rather than the cultural realm, where in the border South it developed in its unique historical context as an antebellum defense against the North's political threat to the institution of slavery and the federal government's direct attacks on slaveholding residents in the ensuing Civil War. In the post-war period, Southern identity became a means by which residents of former slave states sought to reestablish authority in defiance of federal authority during and after the war itself. Southern identity in the former Confederacy, in the historian C. Benton Woodward's words, stemmed directly from what he called a post-war Civil War experience of, quote, frustration, failure, and defeat. By 1865, even before the war had concluded, many of these border states had begun scripting their Southern identity, centering it largely upon the destruction of slavery and their respective states' own ill-fated stances within, rather than without the Union. Missouri's Southern white identity, should I say, then was in essence born of an ideology of defiance, itself the product of a political process through which the federal government forced emancipation at the point of the bayonet. Indeed, in one of his short stories, and after an admittedly brief personal introduction to the state's war as a Confederate, or should I say as a secessionist, Missouri's most famous 19th century observer, Samuel Clemens, also known as Mark Twain, recounted his understanding of this, what he called, natural transition of the state's rural populace, white populace, to the intrusion of war, as well as his own construction of regional identity in 1885. Coincident to the same Confederate Renaissance that I've mentioned, from something Western to something Southern, and this is his brief quote. Out West, there was a good deal of confusion in men's minds during the first months of the Great Trouble, meaning the war, a good deal of unsettledness, of leaning first this way, then that, then the other way. It was hard for us to get our bearings. Our state was invaded by the Union forces. There were scores of little camps scattered over Missouri, composed of young men who had been born and reared to a sturdy independence and who did not know what it meant to be ordered around by Tom, Dick, and Harry, whom they had known familiarly all their lives in the village or on the farm. The same thing was happening all over the South. Though no allegory, the story offers its readers a clear metaphor. This is the most recent Joe Shelby monument in Kansas City. In Sam Clemens' own mind, in the space of but one of Mark Twain's paragraphs, war had transformed what was once the West into the South, at least in the minds of whites. Thanks very much for listening.